Welcome to the next learning unit in the chapter PV system design. This unit will deal with the PV system layout. Now that we have learned the essential basics about how to choose the orientation and tilt angle for the modules, we can move on to the question of how we want to connect the inverter to our system. We have several options. The modules of a plant can be connected in parallel or in series, or even both. The plant can have only one inverter or several ones. The inverters differ depending on how the modules are connected and the size of the PV plant. So let's take a look at what kind of system sizes we can basically distinguish. Among the most numerically installed plants are small PV plants on residential buildings. These plants usually have an output power between 2 and 20 kilowatt peak. However, these values only provide a rough guideline. PV systems on apartment buildings can also be significantly larger than 20 kilowatt peak. So-called plug-in PV systems are usually much smaller than 2 kilowatt peak. Larger plants can be found on commercial roofs, for example, on warehouses. Here the plants quickly reach sizes of several hundred kilowatt peak. The largest plants are ground-mounted PV systems. Of course, there are also small ground-mounted PV systems, but for the larger solar parks, the size ranges today from several megawatt to several gigawatt. In practice, plant size is a crucial factor in choosing a PV system design, but it is not the only one. Let's first look at what we basically have to consider when connecting the modules. In order for an inverter to achieve optimum efficiency, all modules connected together in a string should generate a similar current. Otherwise, the current of the weakest module limits the current of the entire string, resulting in avoidable power losses. As an example, let's look at a system in which differently oriented roof surfaces are covered with modules. Due to the different irradiation on the roof surface, the module deliver a different current. To avoid power losses, the modules of the two roof surfaces should not be connected in a common string. The same applies to shading situations. If it is unavoidable that modules are shaded during the course of the day, these modules should be combined into one string. The permanently unshaded modules should also form a separate string. However, if the shading moves over the entire plant during the course of the day, it is often difficult to find an optimal string layout. In practice, there's a broad range of options for dealing with these interconnection problems. We will take a closer look at these in the following slides. Let's start with the most commonly installed inverter concept, the string inverter. As the name suggests, with a string inverter, all modules of the systems are connected in series to a string, and this module string is then connected to the inverter. The vast majority of systems on residential buildings are equipped with such a string inverter. To protect the inverter from the weather, it is usually not directly installed next to the modules, but in the basement of the house or technical room. The reason for connecting the modules in series and not in parallel is the same as for connecting the cells in the module. The ohmic power losses increase quadratically with the current. Modules are therefore connected in series whenever possible. By connecting the modules in series, the module voltages add up and quickly lead to voltages of up to 1500 watt on the DC side of the system. Since DC voltages of 120 volt and above are life-threatening, various safety precautions must be taken above this value, for example double insulation of the cables and the modules. The regulations for these are country-specific. A typical solar module has an MPP voltage of about 34 to 40 volt. Therefore, in very small systems with three or fewer modules, the critical voltage of 120 volt is not reached. So no further safety precautions need to be taken. As we have just seen, When planning a system with string inverter, it is important to ensure that all modules of a string are oriented similarly and that no or only short-term shading occurs. If different orientations or shading cannot be avoided, it may be a good idea to use a module inverter. Module inverters typically have power ratings of a few hundred watts and are connected to a single module at a time. They're relatively small devices, similar in size to a module's junction box. They're usually mounted on the back of the modules. Because each module has its own inverter, each module is always operated at its maximum power, regardless of the orientation or possible shading of the other modules. Thus, no mismatch losses occur in the system. Another advantage of the module inverters comes from the fact that they are mounted directly on the back of the module. This eliminates the need for DC wiring to the modules, which in turn reduces system costs. Last but not least, a PV system with module inverters can be expanded as needed. So, if more modules are to be installed after a few years, there is no problem with module inverters. This would not be so easy with systems using string inverters, as for string inverters, there's a maximum number of modules due to its maximum input voltage. However, module inverters also have some disadvantages, which are responsible for the fact that this technology is a niche market so far, at least in Europe. In the US, module inverters representing a plug-and-play concept are more popular. But also in Europe, the so-called guerrilla or plug-in photovoltaics of modules on the balcony of private homes is often based on module inverters, and it's becoming more and more popular. One major problem with module inverters is that they are mounted on the roof with the modules. As a result, they are exposed to wind, weather, and above all, high temperature fluctuations, which greatly affects the service life of the module inverters and can lead to premature failure. In any case, the lifetime of an inverter is much shorter than that of a PV module, whether it's a string or a module inverter. It can be assumed that an inverter needs to be replaced after about 10 years. The replacement of a module inverter is possible, but due to the installation on the back of the module on the roof, it is associated with a significant effort. While this can still be done easily with small systems, the effort increases with increasing system size. With a string inverter, on the other hand, replacement is comparatively simple, since it is usually located at an easy accessible place and only one inverter needs to be replaced. Another disadvantage results from the low voltage of a single PV module, which is typically around 34 to 40 volt. Module inverters are therefore always two-stage devices with boost converters. Due to the immense difference between input and output voltage, the losses in the boost converter are comparatively high, which leads to a somewhat lower overall efficiency of the inverter. Now let's look at the specific costs for PV systems. Costs are often related to watt peak, that is, to the rated power or the power that the modules would deliver under STC conditions. Of all the inverter concepts, module inverters have the highest cost per watt peak. However, especially for small systems with heavy shading or different module orientations, these higher costs can be compensated by higher yield. An alternative to module inverters are so-called power optimizers, which became more and more popular during the past years. The concept mainly combines the advantage of a string and a module inverter. These power optimizers are basically DC-DC converters. They take over the MPP tracking on module level. The modules with their MPPTs are connected in series, like in a string inverter, and then connected to the DC side of the inverter, in which the MPP tracking has to be deactivated or is not installed from the beginning. The series connection of the modules is also one of the main advantages of the power optimizers concept compared to module inverters. With module inverters, the modules are connected in parallel, leading to higher power losses in the cable. The voltage of a system with string inverters are usually higher than 230 volt, leading to lower ohmic losses in the cables. Furthermore, Power losses due to DC current are lower than those to AC current at comparable voltage level. On the other hand, in the case of failure of another module inverter, this has no effect on the other modules. However, in a system with power optimizers, basically all power optimizers are connected in series. If one power optimizer fails, the entire module string fails. Another disadvantage compared to module inverters is the expandability of the plant. With this concept, the system cannot be expanded easily, since the voltage limit of the inverter must be observed. On the other hand, the specific costs are lower compared to a system with module inverters, since the conversion to alternating current takes place centrally and not individually for each module. Furthermore, the efficiency of the system with power optimizers is better than that of the module inverters, since the losses in the boost converter are reduced or even eliminated. A string inverter is only suitable for a limited number of modules, due to the increasing DC voltage with increasing number of modules in series. No more modules can be added at a string voltage of 1500 volt at the latest. This corresponds to about 40 modules at an MPP voltage of 34 to 40 volt. However, a large commercial rooftop installation can quickly contain many times this number of modules. Such a system would then consist of many string inverters. Therefore, in terms of cost and system complexity, in such installation, most commonly multi-string inverters are used. Such multi-string inverters contain several MPP trackers, to each of which one or sometimes several module strings can be connected. This can also be advantageous if strings differ, for example, in terms of module orientation and module type. Each string is then operated in its individual MPP. The current of the individual strings is combined in parallel and forwarded to the inverter. A series connection of the strings is not possible here due to the voltage limitation. Multi-string inverters can have rated powers of several hundred kilowatt. If the plant is even larger, again several multi-string inverters must be used. However, a ground-mounted plant with several hundred megawatts would require more than 1,000 multi-string inverters. The system is much simpler if a central inverter is used. A central inverter is designed for much higher currents. Here, many module strings are connected in parallel and then connected to the inverter. The inverter has only one MPP tracker, so all modules are operated at the same voltage. This naturally leads to mismatch losses, which are higher compared to a system with many multi-string inverters. However, a system of this size is usually a ground-mounted system in which all modules have the same orientation. The mismatch between modules here is mainly due to the electrical parameters, voltage drops in the line, and the partial shading or soiling of the modules. The relative losses due to mismatching are usually in the range of 1 to 3% for a central inverter. In addition, the probability of inverter failure increases with each electronic component. As a result, a plant with many inverters has a higher overall risk of failure than a plant with a single inverter. For this reason, central inverters are almost always used for plants larger than a few megawatts. In practice, of course, there are plant sizes where both concepts can be considered. In this case, it is necessary to weigh up which advantages outweigh the disadvantages. Finally, I would like to introduce you to a concept that is used especially in countries with low or alternating irradiation. This system concept is based on the fact that the efficiency of an inverter decreases in the lower partial load range. We had a closer look at this in the last teaching unit. In many PV systems, however, it is precisely in this power range that a large part of the energy is generated. To counter this problem, the so-called master-slave concept is used as an alternative to the central inverter. The connection of the modules in this system concept basically corresponds to that of a central inverter. The only difference is that the parallel connected module strings are not connected to a central inverter, but to several parallel connected inverters. When the system is started up, usually in the morning, one of the inverters is nominated as the master. This master initially works alone, as long as the PV system does not exceed its rated power. In addition to the morning and evening hours, this can also be the case on cloudy days or in winter, for example. When the irradiance and thus also the power of the PV plant increases, the master switches on the so-called slaves as required. Since the master in this operating mode performs significantly more operating hours than the slaves, the master function is transferred to one of the slaves after each restart, usually every morning. Due to the better efficiency in partial load range, the overall plant yield can be increased. For example, a plant in Germany can be expected to have an approximately 1% higher yield. However, the mismatch losses with this type of PV system are the same as with the normal central inverter. In order to reduce the mismatch losses as well, the so-called team concept from SMA can be used instead of the master-slave method. Here, each string is first connected to its own inverter. One of the inverters is given the role of the team leader. At low irradiance, the team leader can switch the strings to the other inverters to itself and work alone. With increasing irradiance, it can activate another inverter so that each inverter takes over 50% of the generator power. If the irradiance increases even more, the number of connected inverters is doubled again until finally the entire system operates in string mode. In contrast to the master-slave concept, each inverter can control the operating power of its partial generator independently of the others. Mismatch losses are thus reduced compared to the master-slave concept. Let's summarize what we have learned. The smallest inverters are module inverters, which are especially useful in systems with few modules and different orientations or shading. The string inverters is most commonly used for small systems. Here, all modules are connected to a string, and operated at the same operating point. The power optimizer concept combines the advantages of module and string inverters. In this case, MPP tracking takes place on the module level, but conversion to AC takes place in a string inverter without MPP tracking. With increasing plant size, multi-string inverters are used instead of string inverters. Here, the MPP of the different strings is determined individually, but the conversion into alternating current takes place centrally. Very large systems are operated with one or more central inverters. Several module strings are connected in parallel for this purpose. All modules are operated at the same operating point. We also learned about this master-slave concept and this team concept, which can be used to increase the energy yield in the partial load range. Thank you for your attention.